Today, we have a special guest, somebody that has roots and ties here to the Notre Dame family, a name I think many people will recognize, Meredith Siegfried, and now Madden. We were talking about that. I said, I didn't know it was Madden. She says, well, I'm in a transition as a, it's a new name that I'm working into. Today our guest is Meredith Siegfried. She was appointed the Chief Executive Officer of NORDAM, one of the world's largest independently owned aerospace companies, in July of 2011. Prior to becoming the CEO, she was the Chief Operating Officer, then President, responsible for all repair and manufacturing operations in the United States, Europe, and Asia. Previously to that, she served as Vice President of NORDAM's Repair Group, Vice President of Global Sales and Marketing, and Vice President of NORDAM International. So I think you can see she has quite a broad background experience. Since joining the company in 1999, she's been based in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and has spent considerable time at NORDAM's facilities in the United Kingdom and Singapore. Ms. Siegfried has played a key role in transforming NORDAM into the global aerospace entity that it is today. Before her tenure with NORDAM, she was a senior consultant on mergers and acquisitions, corporate recovery services, and financial advisory with the Arthur Andersen Global Experience Finance Group. Ms. Siegfried is on the board of directors for NORDAM, Ericsson Aircrane Incorporated, SkyWest Incorporated, Smithsonian National Air and Space Museum, the Aerospace Industries Association, the Tulsa Community Foundation Board of Trustees, the Tulsa Airport Authority Board of Trustees, and World Travel Services, LLC. So she is one busy bee. She is also actively involved in numerous charities in the Tulsa community. She graduated from the University of Notre Dame with a degree in finance and earned her Master's of Business Administration from the University of Chicago. And yes, you Ramblers, formerly the Lady Slammers, if they didn't know that, can thank her grandfather Robert and her late father Ray, the founder of NORDAM, for your accommodations, as well as the MBA students whose classroom and wing was also a gift of the Ray Siegfried. So please extend a welcome to one of our very distinguished graduates and a member of one of the greatest Notre Dame families, Meredith Siegfried.
Well, good morning. Should we start with a little cheer? I say go, you say Irish. Go!
Irish.
Go!
Irish.
All right, I always wanted to start like that. So today's a great day for me because I get to talk to you about my three favorite subjects, Notre Dame, NORDAM, and my family. But before I begin, I'd like to familiarize you with a few industry terms as well as some of the products that our company makes so that you understand better what I'm talking about this morning. In short, NORDAM repairs and manufactures airplane parts. And this is a graphic of some of the products we make. And we call this slide radome to tail cone because it highlights what we do. So starting from the front here, I don't know if you can see this, if this little thing's working, but at the front of the airplane is something called the radome. And we manufacture radomes for all the 737 aircraft out in the world. If you fly Southwest Airlines, you're going to be flying they fly a 737, so you're likely flying with one of our radomes. And it essentially is a structural weatherproof enclosure that just covers the antenna, so it's an important part. On the very back end of the airplane, right there, you can see, usually if you see an airplane, you're going to see a hole at the back end, and that's the tail cone. And it's essentially just an exhaust port, but it's not an exhaust for the engine, it's an exhaust for a generator for the aircraft. And we repair the tail cones for many of the world's airlines. Right here, when you look at the engine, see if I can get it there, the housing of the engine, the cover of the engine, is something that's called a nacelle. It's a French word, and it's just essentially a housing around the engine. It's not a movable part. It's just the cover to protect the engine. And on the back end of that nacelle is something called a thrust reverser, and we have it sort of picked up here. On the back side of the thrust reverser is something called, or on the back end of the nacelle is something called the thrust reverser, and that's the brakes of the airplane. It's not like car brakes It actually redirects the airflow of the aircraft so that it'll slow down the airplane. And so we make thrust reversers and nacelles for the business jet world, so we manufacture those, but we repair them for the commercial airlines. And another product we make that we love is all the windows, all the cabin windows. Airbus is one of our largest customers, and if you're flying in an Airbus A320, which is essentially the Airbus version of the 737, if you look at the windows sort of up at the top, you might see our stamp, which is ND. You'll see an ND for NORDAM or Notre Dame. So that's just a little background. And for a little bit more background and perspective, Notre Dame's been a big part of my family's life since my earliest memories. My grandfather, Bobby Siegfried, went to Notre Dame and graduated in 1937. And my father, Ray Siegfried, went to Notre Dame and graduated in 1965. My grandmother on my mom's side went to St. Mary's. I had two uncles on my mom's side graduate in the 70s, and I and five of my siblings graduated with at least one Notre Dame degree. And here you can see my dad on his graduation day with his parents. And here you see a lot of the members of my family who graduated at Notre Dame, and I put some domes around my mom's head because she is an honorary graduate having to live with all these domers. And then there's my newest family. My father-in-law graduated in 61, and my mother-in-law went to St. Mary's and graduated in 62, and my husband, Pete Madden, graduated with me in 1996. And here we are, the very first night we ever met. That's really the picture. Of my Baden St. Patrick's Day dance where we were set up, and I loved him truly from the first time I laid eyes on him. And here we are 18 years later. We finally got married a year ago. We did not go out the entire 18 years. We broke up for 13, and since he's such a, yeah. I finally got him to marry me after all that time. So he's such a doll. I'm going to put a little halo around him. And that's not enough. I'm going to put some hearts and some shamrocks. So anyway, love him a lot. All that just to say that golden blue is the color inside our veins. And this isn't an unusual story for many domers. In fact, I'm sure there are many more families who can tell this same story and with many more generations and many more family graduates. But what I'd like to talk about today is the important role that Notre Dame played in one man's life and the impact that man had on a company. So this is the story of my father, Ray Siegfried, and how he started our business from basically a shack and turned it into a major global enterprise. I'm not sure what drove my dad. Maybe it was the fact that he was little, he was about my height and heels and not too much heavier, or maybe it was the fact that he really wanted to become someone, but he wanted the world to know that he was good and he was strong. And when he was in grade school and high school, he learned how to box and wrestle and ride horses, and he was pretty good at all of them. He made the Notre Dame wrestling and the boxing teams. He won the Bengal bouts at Notre Dame and the Golden Gloves in the Army, and he even won some local rodeos. Regardless of what it was, he had the do-or-die, never-quit, fighting Irish attitude that made it possible. At the age of 26, having graduated from Notre Dame and now fresh out of the Army, he went to work for his grandfather in the insurance business. But it was too sedate for a young man who was ready to roar. So Dad convinced his grandfather to let him take over a tiny, near-bankrupt operation on which his grandfather held a performance bond for a contract that looked doomed to fail. And so it was, whether it was divine intervention, fate, a hunch, or simply faith, Dad spotted his destiny in that little rundown company called Northeastern Oklahoma Repair and Development and Manufacture, NORDAM for short. He thought it profound that those six letters appear in the words Notre Dame and also in that same order. The Notre Dame stamp was all over him. He determined that our company colors would be gold and blue, and he reminded everybody about the golden rule. Aside from his college degree and his Army service, he had nothing at all to recommend him except some smarts, some unwavering optimism, and dogged determination. He had no experience whatsoever in engineering, manufacturing, repair, or shop work. Yet he took this little machine shop that had no recognition in aerospace, an outdated facility, a management team, and five metal workers who expected to be laid off any day. And he took it and he turned it into something great. NORDAM's now a global aerospace company with $500 million in sales, over 2,500 employees, in 10 facilities on three continents, and sales representatives in 19 countries. We serve the repair and manufacturing needs of the world's commercial airlines, the business jet manufacturers, and the military. But let's return to the beginning of the story and see how it got that way. As I've said, the company was born in humble, unromantic, and desperate circumstances. This was the company's first home. And this is the picture of the only work they had at the time. It's a contract for a company called LTV for a military A7A fin cap. And you can see in the picture on the left of the aircraft that it was on. And it was on the very tip of the tail. That it was a cap, it's not a structural part. So it's a pretty simple part. It was a military carrier-capable subsonic light attack aircraft. And it was non-performance on that contract that threatened the performance of the company. The company lost $250,000 in the first 3 months, but became profitable in 1971, its second full year of operation, which included the successful completion of the original LTV contract and the salvation of that performance bond. Dad understood that early on, the company needed focus and expertise. He hired two key managers that expertly managed engineering and production and farsightedly invested in new equipment even before there were orders. They did that while he handled the sales. And what a hodgepodge of sales he brought in. Those early years had us involved in building portable shelters for the Army and the FAA, as seen in this slide, and small portable aircraft hangars and passenger seats and tray tables. But the most unusual product that they built was a product called the folding fish boat called the Clam. Had nothing to do with aerospace. And I can't imagine what some of your professors would say about product focus with this menagerie going on. But it all worked out, and by the end of 1973, the company had 100 employees and $3 million in sales. This is probably one of my favorite slides. It's a picture of my dad and my mom at a trade show. And as you can see, I think my dad used every resource that he had, including my mom. And there she is trying to sell something. Through the late 1970s, growth was slow but steady. At that time, when certain aircraft parts were badly damaged, the airline's primary option was to buy new. And Dad and his team were convinced that repairs could be developed instead, which would greatly reduce the airline's operating costs and turn times. So with permission, they began foraging through the American Airlines boneyard to test their concept. And with that, the market for composite repairs was created. Now, what that means is that NORDAM figured out a way to repair airplane parts so that the airlines didn't have to buy new parts all the time. And this is something that NORDAM's very well known for, creating the repair business. It's our hallmark in the industry and provides about 30% of our revenues. In the next 10 years, we wouldn't only grow our existing business, but also make several acquisitions, achieve engineering breakthroughs, and develop new products that would dramatically grow our business from the mid-1980s through 2001. We added more capabilities, equipment, and new product lines that grew into divisions requiring their own new facilities. We established an international marketing arm with offices in Europe and Asia. And we opened new production facilities at home and abroad. And we even received some very fun projects like the interior work for the Air Force One and work on the private jet of the King of Saudi Arabia that you can see in this picture. Just an interesting side note on this, every room in this airplane has a compass that points east towards Mecca. And very significantly, we had gotten an early start in developing a noise abatement product that was mandated along with deregulation in 1977. And essentially just what that means is that the FAA mandated quieter airplanes by the early 90s. And we developed this product called the Hush Kit, and we that made these airplanes become quiet. So NORDAM made hush kits for dozens of aircraft across the globe. And the hush kit really put us on the map. It and our success in the repair business proved to our customers that we were good at coming up with creative alternatives and solutions to their problems. Between 1994 and 2001, we ramped up on the base for which we still stand today. We made two major acquisitions, which led to the roll-up of the nacelle and thrust reverser business jet manufacturing world, meaning that for business jets of a certain size, we estimate we have a very significant piece of the market because of those acquisitions and because we continue to develop more reversers and nacelles for the business jet world. These are products, again, for which NORDAM is well known. And today, thrust reversers, nacelles, and structures are the bread and butter of our business worldwide. The graph attests to the banner years we were enjoying when those planes hit New York and Pennsylvania on September 11th and changed the airline industry forever. Within 30 days of that awful time, NORDAM was also hit directly twice by events unique to us. Our president was killed in a private airplane crash that took also the lives of two others. And at the same time, Dad, who was our chairman and CEO, was diagnosed with ALS, also known as Lou Gehrig's disease. Those events were not only personally tragic to so many of us, but they also brought on a succession crisis. But our first order of business had to be our customers, who were very badly hurt. We knew we had to help them, so we mostly met our airline customers' requirements for across-the-board price discounts. We resized our U.S. facilities, and with reluctance and sadness, we were also forced into several layoffs. At the time, we knew we had to continue investing in our future so we would be ready when the upturn came. We contracted to develop a state-of-the-art enterprise system, SAP, that would connect all of our global facilities. We invested in new and more efficient quality and operational systems, and we made another major acquisition. We also created and implemented a formal succession plan and officially adopted an independent board of directors. Returning to the graph again, we were recovering well when in 2008, the recession hit. And once again, we were reinventing ourselves and using the valley to invest in tomorrow's peak. Now, fast forward to today. It's been 10 years since Dad's passing, and the torch has been returned to our family. We're a different company now in many ways. We've modernized, introduced new quality process, standardized practices across the globe, and have drawn more professionals into our ranks. But we've always continued on in Dad's spirit, promoting his and mom's values and keeping alive his sense of fun in the workplace. In the early 1970s, when my father was getting NORDAM through its precarious infancy, he had also had a young and growing family. There would eventually be six children, and the earliest memories of all of us include playing around the shop and equipment and offices at NORDAM on the weekend, and it was just fabulous fun, and I'd even call it a wonderland. One major highlight was the day that Dad brought home a helicopter for us to play in the backyard. That's a pretty good present he brought home. And we were always aware that we were part of the family business in the aviation industry. And Dad passed his passion along to us for that business. But he, along with Mom, instilled values in us too. Dad believed in saying the rosary every Sunday night as a family, and we were expected to attend Mass on Sunday no matter where we were in the world. Good grooming was imperative. We weren't allowed to wear jeans except in special outdoor settings, like at a ranch or a baseball game. We couldn't even wear them to a Notre Dame football game. And we were taught the business at a very young age. Dad taught us more through show and tell, while Mom forced the discipline by hiring a family business trainer. We were given performance reviews at a very early age, on paper and in his office. My sister had many, many performance reviews. Most of all, though, they taught us to treat every single human being with kindness and respect, to always do the right thing, and to give back to the community. And they taught by example. One vivid memory is that my parents borrowed money to respond to Notre Dame's request for a new dormitory, which became Siegfried Hall, because they believed that doing good things for others was always right. Now that the Siegfried children are grown and four of them work at NORDAM, we've applied our early learnings, our Catholic education, and our parents' deeply held values in the way we run our business and in the atmosphere we create. We recognize that we've been given a gift and that we hold responsibility for a tremendous asset, not just one that serves the industry, but one that serves people, our customers, and our stakeholders, and others in the common world. We think a lot about what it means to be a good corporate citizen and about what our responsibility is as owners and managers and caretakers of the business. NORDAM's always prided itself on its culture, which we strive to make a showcase for our values. My father long ago began calling our employees stakeholders, and even when the company ranks grew to 2,500, he knew every one of them by name and made it a point to stroll regularly through the shops and offices, chatting with old friends and making new ones. When he passed away in 2005, we, the second generation, worked to carry on with that tradition. And in the past few years, we've really turned it up a notch by putting personality and fun into the workplace and instilling the concept of caring for individuals into our daily mindset. And I have to add here that when it comes to giving to others, our stakeholders regularly amaze us with their big-hearted enthusiasm by giving to United Way or to taking care of their fellow stakeholders when they have a crisis. We've increased the number and quality of stakeholder events on the annual calendar, including heavy participation by family members. Halloween's probably the most fun work day of the year, with hundreds of stakeholders in costume receiving candy and prizes and hosting their own creative display. Now, all these pictures are pictures of people in my family. So Kiss was what we were in 2014, and the very tall one there who's playing Gene Simmons is my youngest brother, Bailey. My mom, actually, is Tommy Thayer, the one that has a little cat face. I think she's in the middle. Yeah. I have another brother, Terrell, but you can see we have a great time for Halloween, and we never tell anybody what we're going to be. We just like to go out and surprise them. So we have a lot of fun, and we've introduced an open house at all of our facilities so that our stakeholders and their children and family could experience some of the same fun that we did when we were children, and so that that people could attend and learn what their mom and dad or husband and wife do all day while they're at NORDAM. In working towards our goal of becoming Oklahoma's premier employer, we offer our stakeholders additional benefits, discounts for memberships at local workout facilities, a free on-site health clinic in collaboration with Johns Hopkins University, and contracts with food providers to deliver pre-ordered lunch or dinner to our facilities during the workday while they're at work. We launched a Ray Siegfried Leadership Academy, which focuses on becoming serving leaders, which means that leaders succeed by serving their people and recognizing their responsibility to provide the support necessary for individuals to achieve their own success. Lastly, we believe in good behavior, not just legally, but ethically and morally as well. We have standards and we expect all of our leaders to walk the talk when it comes to living up to them, even when it's difficult. We actually do have a family-like atmosphere and organization where people treat each other with fairness and respect and really do care about each other. And I believe that our culture and our success can be traced back to my parents' training and values and the educational and spiritual reinforcement that we all received as students at Notre Dame. My parents always believed in giving back, and while they contributed to and participated in many charitable institutions, most of them in Tulsa, Notre Dame was dearest to my father's heart. Over the years, my parents funded the building of Siegfried Hall and the Siegfried MBA wing of the College of Business Administration, and they sponsored the Siegfried Chair in Entrepreneurial Studies and the Ray Milland Professor of Management. And it was a source of great pride for Dad to be awarded an honorary law degree in 2001 and to become a member of the Board of Trustees in 1987. After his death, he was memorialized at Notre Dame by the Ray Siegfried Leadership Award, which is given annually to a senior that exemplifies the qualities of leadership, generosity, and devotion to Catholic faith and athletics. For many years now, South Bend's been like a second home. In fact, we do have a condo here, and not only do we attend football games and other events, but we also have celebrations and have spent holidays here. And now we have another special reason to come, to visit Dad's gravesite. Everything he most loved is represented on this monument: his wife, Notre Dame, NORDAM, our Catholic grade in high schools, Culver Military Academy, and his aerospace friends. And if you look here on the back of the stone, it features all the graduation dates of his children. One was blank because they were still in school, and we had to chisel that one in. So he was proud of us, and he was very proud of Notre Dame, and we're proud of them too. As I close this presentation about my father and the founding evolution of NORDAM, I'd like to remind everybody that my father had a partner in all of this, a partner that was as strong, as dedicated, and as involved, and as wonderful as he was. And that would be my mom, who's sitting here, Milland Siegfried, who is the most important person in his life. And I'll end with a little picture of she and Dad, one of them at a Notre Dame game. Thank you, Notre Dame, for continuing our educational and spiritual reinforcement. And thank you, Mom, for giving us the tools that we needed to be successful and take care of our family, friends, and institutions that we love. So.
We're going to open this up to questions, so I'll give you a second to formulate them, but I want to start off with the first question. First, I'd like to make a comment. You haven't aged since that black and white. You look good. That's amazing. Yeah. But obviously, you are a key part of the upbringing and the leadership that your daughter displays. But I'd like to ask you a question. And it's kind of putting, going back, roughly 20 years ago, you're in a seat like this, you're a finance senior or junior. How did you see, obviously there's some family ties that led you down the course you did, but yet you still had to learn, and you've had all kinds of experience, everything from marketing to operations management, supply management, and you start off as a finance with the traditional route, going into like in the acquisitions and mergers, something like that. But what through your career, because a lot of people will sit here and get a little bit anxious about what am I going to do? How's my life going to go forward? Where am I going to get that initial job? And where am I going to be 5, 15, 20 years? So I'd like you to reflect a little bit maybe and provide a little more insight on, the path that you've taken and some of the key things along the way from professional development that are unique for your story and something that they may, experience themselves someday and maybe help guide them in embracing those opportunities. And I apologize for that long statement / question.
What was the question?
Yeah.
I'd say when you graduate and you really can't go wrong, I think, in your first job. If you get a job at a large company, I mean, there's just tons of things to learn about process, about how to work with people, about you learn a lot of the basic skills that you need. I went to Arthur Andersen and I was in their corporate finance group, and that to me was just a fantastic first job. I got to really learn. It's one thing to analyze something in school, they give you all the information, you analyze it. It's another thing to learn a process at a company. They have a way of doing it. Heck, at the time, I think we used, the internet was just coming out. And I remember that was a big deal, and doing email and, but learning a lot of, how people work, how to analyze a company in true life. How to work with clients. So a big company has a lot of benefit, and it was a great, great training ground to go to a big company and then come to a smaller company. But I also think there's a ton of value in going to a small company because at a smaller company, you have the opportunity to do a lot of things that you wouldn't do at a large company, because you get put into, here's your role and don't reach outside this role. But at a company like NORDAM, if you have, if you're willing to, take on more, to pick up, in our management team, from me to, vice presidents to directors, we have to put together PowerPoints. We have to write our own letters. You have to understand operations, finance, banking. There's just a whole different array of what you have to do in a smaller company than you get to do in a big company. So my feeling is, first job, take full advantage of it, no matter where you are. Learn, engage, put your own personality into it. One thing that there's culture at companies, but you can bring your attitude and your personality and also impact that company. And so I'd say enjoy it, learn. There's going to be things. I remember my first job also, I thought I got out of college and I was going to be doing awesome things. And I remember I got sent to, now mind you, I was living in Houston and I'm from Tulsa, Oklahoma. I get sent to Bartlesville, Oklahoma to dig through boxes at, what was it? Phillips 66. And I'm thinking, for 3 weeks, I think I was in a warehouse going through and looking for remediation documents. I had no idea what I was looking for either. So, it's one of those things where, you're surprised, but eventually you start moving through the organization and, but you're constantly learn, constantly take the opportunities to do whatever that company wants you to do. But just remember, put your own personality in it and make it a good place for the people around you.
I think we got one. I love Halloween too, so I was just wondering what your family was going to be for Halloween this year.
Well, that's a good question. So, and we have a big, we talk about it for some time. We don't release it to the company, so please, nobody, let our company know what we are. This year, we are the Lion King. So I'm looking forward to that.
Thanks for coming out. Being that you guys make repair parts for the aircraft, I just want to know what your relationship was like with the OEMs, the manufacturers.
That's a good question. It's very good. So we have a joint venture with General Electric in our facility in Wales. And, you know, we actually do manufacturing work for them. And we have a relationship where we actually are their GE's or Middle River, which is the company that does CF6ADC2 work. We actually are their repair house. So for us, it's very good. Now, I know what you're talking about there because it's a, you know, there's a, especially in the engine, world where things are movable and can really bring an aircraft down. There's a lot of companies out there that PMA parts, which is means they remanufacture them and put them on planes and sell them. There's a lot of people out there that don't have good relationships with the OEMs, but ours actually is very good. We're an Airbus designated repair house, the only one in North America. We make the Boeing 737 radome for Boeing. So we have a, you know, I think we're a little bit different maybe because we've been around a long time and we're the largest, but we do, you know, we work the relationship through contracts and things of that nature.
Missy. Meredith, like your dad, you were also a student athlete here at NORDAM. Can you talk a little bit about how you draw on the experience that you had as a student athlete in your work with the company?
Well, I always pay attention to athletes or people that have stuff outside of, you know, outside of just their student life, so or their educational life. I think that being an athlete, and I wasn't a great one. You know, you learn how to manage your daily life or all your time very well. So, because you have to be able to do your student work. You have to be able to manage your life with sports, and then you have your life outside of that. And so, I think that that really helps a person be organized very well. I also would say that some of my younger brothers would say that they like that I'm in charge of the company because they know that I'm highly competitive and that I'm gonna make sure that we get where we need to go. And I do think that, you know, being an athlete, you learn to work as a team, which is important, and also being an athlete, you learn competition, and you know, that's every single day out in the world, someone's trying to take a product or a dollar from you, and you're trying to make sure it gets into your shop. So I think that's one of the greatest things that I learned as an athlete.
With so many global operations, how do you kind of manage everything from Tulsa when it's spread across time zones and there's so many people with different cultures, and how do you make sure everyone's driving to the same thing?
You know, something that I learned, I think, in school, it's a good terminology, is that you have a strategy, and then you have a structure that supports the strategy, and then you have routines that support that structure and strategy. So for us, we, you know, hire excellent leaders that will manage that facility overseas or in a different location, and then we have a routine that, like, when I was running our international businesses, you know, every morning at 7 o'clock, we would have phone calls. Every, you know, I'd have phone calls with Singapore in the morning, and in about 10 o'clock, I'd be talking to Europe, and then later, I'd be talking to Mexico. So, you know, you have to work the routines. You have to go over and visit and see it with your own eyes and walk and meet the customers to make sure things are happening the way you're being told they're happening. But that's probably the best way is, you know, you got to have your routines that support it. You have to work different hours quite a bit. And when we have, you know, you're working nights and mornings quite a bit, and then you're filling in the day with your U.S. stuff.
Yeah, Meredith, from a corporate strategy, where do you see potential growth for your company, and how do you approach that particularly? Do you stay within that industry? Do you start to think about broadening the scope beyond aircraft or something like that? You know, hopefully not back to clam boats, but just curious as to where you see NORDAM going from here.
So the thing that drives me crazy, and I think everybody crazy, you've seen this graph here that looks like a seesaw. I think it's, if you can, maybe I skipped it here, but you can see how volatile that is. That is not fun. And especially when you're a private company and the only way that you fund your business is through what you generate, the cash of the operation, and through our banks and through our own pockets. And so that is not fun. So what we're working to do is fill in those gaps and make it less volatile, make it less dramatic. So part of, you know, I talked about the commercial airline business, that's repair business, and the other part of our business is business jet oriented. Now the business jet business is extremely volatile. So it works with, you know, when you have it works with the wealth in society. So the more, the better the stock market's doing, the more wealth that's created, that you'll see that, you know, we take off, and when it's not, it's really ugly. So what we're trying to do is actually fill in those valleys by adding more production with Airbus, Boeing, Embraer. Long-term production cycles is what will help us there, as well as actually we don't have tons of military work, and military like the F-35, some of these other production cycles will fill that in. The third thing that we're focused on is actually services, and we're working on composite training for a whole arm where we go out and train the customers on how to do a lot of the work, a lot of their own repair work. As well as we're working on some, let's say, software programs that'll take us to a whole different level of generation. No, you know, I know what they're thinking. They're thinking, maybe I'll get 30 minutes back and get out for lunch early. That's what I'd be thinking.
So we have a couple of former military pilots in the room, and we'd just like to know what your favorite military aircraft is.
Well, the F-16, because my brother flies it. He's in the Air Guard, and he just became head of the base in Tulsa. So very happy with that. I do love the F-35, even though it's having a lot of struggle. The old Harrier, because I like the way it, you know, goes up and down and forward. So what about yours?
I would have to say it's
nice.
Meredith, NORDAM is one of the largest employers in Tulsa, with operations in other locations around the world. But can you speak to your commitment, NORDAM's commitment to the local community in terms of service and philanthropy and the impact you guys are committed to making there?
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of an interesting environment. So we only have 2,500 people, probably, you know, 1,800 are in Tulsa, but that is a large employer. And so, and as I said when I was talking, that you know, we do pay attention to the environment and what our responsibility is, not just for for creating profit, but also for creating jobs and for, you know, trying to create a good environment in Tulsa. You know, so we get a lot of attention in Tulsa, whether we have a layoff, and you know, that's never fun, and you can talk about what's the ethical thing to do there or what's the right thing to do there. But and we get a lot of attention the other way. If we have, you know, you win a little piece of business, you know, you get coverage. So, you know, I think that we are important in Tulsa because, you know, we do employ a lot of people, and that's important, especially in times when the oil and gas business is in a trough and we have businesses moving out of state. So our commitment really is we do want to grow our business in Tulsa. I mean, we have visions of being much larger. It'll take probably 5 to 10 years to get where we'd like to go. But we really think that we can employ, we can be the largest employer in Tulsa. It'll be hard to be larger than American Airlines base, which is, you know, I don't remember how many people they have, but they're very large. And then you have the hospitals and the schools, which are in a whole different category. But we are committed to being in Tulsa. We like to grow our employment base, but it's not easy because a lot of times it's easier or more productive, more profitable to send work down to Mexico because the labor rates and are less down there. There is, you know, incentives that countries will give you, reduced tax. They will help. They will pay and build your buildings for you. So it's definitely something you have to do. You need to be overseas, but I think our base will always be in Tulsa.
Hi there. Can you tell us a little bit about the family element of your business, perhaps some challenges you face working with brothers and parents?
You might ask my mother that.
Maybe the both of you.
So I have to say that we've been really lucky. As I mentioned in the speech, we were trained very young. We learned a lot about the business. We also had different rules that were put in place. You had to graduate, you know, with a degree. You had to work outside the business for a certain number of years. There had to be a job that opened up. You had to apply for it and start at the same or lesser position that you did where you were. So those are some things that are a baseline. Another thing is that everybody in our family was educated. So it's that's good because I've seen a lot of family businesses where, you know, a lot of the kids didn't, you know, have an education. I mean, number one, education is critical. And I'd also say that when my dad died, so we worked together, several of us, but when my dad died, it also brought us together towards a common goal. You know, when he, you know, people weren't competing for the job, you know, and maybe it was a little bit more where you're like, what's my goal? How do I get up to the top? But when dad died, I think it became like, wait a minute, how do we, you know, it was very easy to coalesce around my mother, around the company, and say, wait a minute, we want to keep this company, we want to grow it, and we need to take care of each other, our mother, and this company, because it'll take care of us. So that made it easier, and everybody sort of fell into their own roles. Now, that being said, we, like many family businesses, have had our own issues. We have my oldest brother, left the company and started, bought a business that competed. So that's been, you know, a very big challenge and very hurtful in a lot of ways. We had one of my uncles sued our family, and we're working through it all. The good thing is that we have 5 kids in my family. There's 6 total. So we have 5, they're all very aligned, know the goal, work together. and including my mother, and we're the 80% owners of the company. So it's fun. I will tell you, I love working with my brothers. Love it. It's I went to the Air and Space Museum on Smithsonian Air and Space Museum in D.C. on Tuesday and Wednesday this week for a board meeting. And there's a dinner the night before. You can take your spouse or someone. And my husband's he's a doctor. He's in his residency. So I took my brother, one of my brothers, Terrell. And it was so much fun to be together and to have a little time alone. We go to the trade shows together. And you actually have, while you have a professional relationship, you do fall back into screwing around a little bit. So like at one trade show, there were those massage chairs and your feet hurt. And so we all are in the massage chairs or doing different things that make it really fun. So for me, it's very rewarding to be part of the family business. And I would say everybody that works at NORDAM really does their job well. And they understand, the chain of command. And ultimately, we can have discussions just like anybody with my management team. But, ultimately, I make the decision, if it gets to that. I mean, they make their own decisions and they're in the area they're responsible for. But, certain ones, I have to make. And they support them, and they support them well.
One of the most refreshing things about your presentation is clearly a commitment to a healthy work-life balance for your employees. Could you possibly speak to your own work-life balance? Clearly, family is a very important thing to you. But as a CEO of a multinational corporation, do you find that it's very difficult to separate work from life?
I'm sorry, I couldn't.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Where are you from?
I'm from London.
London.
Yeah. So I was saying that clearly you have a great commitment to a work-life balance with your employees. Could you speak to your own work-life balance? Do you find it difficult being a CEO of a multinational corporation and creating that balance?
Work-life balance. So I think there's different things that are different times of your life, so things sort of change. So I was always sort of probably a workhorse, and that's what I did. I mean, I worked, but I loved it. I mean, I absolutely love what I did, whether it was, and I think I would love working probably anywhere, but I love tremendously working at our company because you have a stake in it. We're trying to get somewhere. You're working with your family, but for me, when I was at Arthur Andersen, they knew that they could call me at 11 o'clock at night and I would come and work for them. They knew that they could call and say, on Sunday, you need to get on a plane with no notice. So there was a period where, where I worked all the time, but I enjoyed it. And, it was just constantly taking in information and learning, and that was great. I always, though, ran in the morning or did my workouts. Not a big person for going out. Always tried to keep healthy, but I did work a lot. And then I'd say, life changes at different times. I would say that people would say I still work a lot, but I like to sometimes be home working, because you can do it on the internet on the weekends. But people probably would tease about me and the work-life balance, but I've really worked hard to, put fun in the workplace and be a part of it and participate, whether it's our picnics or the Halloween, which is just the best day. I mean, nothing gets done on Halloween but Halloween. I don't know necessarily. I like to go fly fishing. I like to work out. I like to, I don't know what else I like to do. Play golf. Yeah, that's right. I do like to play golf. But I usually don't do it during the week. I usually do it on the weekend. But at least I have a weekend. Some people don't.
Well, Meredith, I'd like to thank you. And first off, if your husband's not into all those things, I am. So if you need a buddy to go fly fishing, golfing, please give me a call. But I greatly appreciate you taking the time and being with us today, your family, again, for everything you've done for Notre Dame. You talked about the Ray Siegfried Award that we named it. It was named after your father for leadership. It was quite an honor 2 years ago to nominate Liz Tucker, one of our soccer captains, valedictorian candidate, and she received that award. And I know she's in the Chicago area doing very well right now herself. But it means a lot to us for you taking this time. And again, thank you.
Thank you. Go Irish.